Good morning and welcome to Tunbridge Wells Baptist Church Online. My name is Phil. Welcome wherever you are, whatever time zone you're in, and whether you're watching now or catching up later. It's good to have you with us. As we start worship, some words from Psalm 121. I lift up my eyes to the hills. Where does my help come from? My help comes from the Lord, the maker of heaven and earth. He will not let your foot slip. He who watches over you will not slumber. The Lord watches over you. The Lord is your shade at your right hand. The sun will not harm you by day, nor the moon by night. The Lord will keep you from all harm. He will watch over your life. The Lord will watch over your coming and going, both now and forevermore. Fantastic words, and at this time of uncertainty, when many are fearful for their jobs, what the future may hold, I was struck anew by the promise the Lord will watch over our lives, not just now, but in all the days to come. Let's just have a moment of prayer. Lord, in this time of uncertainty and distress, sustain and support those who are anxious and fearful, and lift up all who are brought low, that we might rejoice in your comfort, knowing that nothing can separate us from your love and care. In Jesus' name, amen. And now we'll hand over to Jack and Alice for a time of song worship.
Blessed be your name. Blessed be your name. When I'm found in the desert place, though I walk through the wilderness, blessed be your name. And every blessing you pour out, turn back to praise. When the darkness closes in, Lord, still I will say, blessed be your name of the Lord, blessed be your name, blessed be the name of the Lord, blessed be your glory. Blessed be your name. When the sun's shining down on me, when the world's all as it should be, blessed be your name. Blessed be your name. On the road marked with suffering, though there's pain in the offering, blessed be your name. Every blessing you pour out, I'll turn back to praise. When the darkness closes in, Lord, still I will say, blessed be the name of the Lord, blessed be your name. Blessed be your glorious name. Blessed be the name of the Lord. Blessed be your name. Blessed be the name of the Lord. Blessed be your glorious name. You give and take away. You give and take away. My heart will choose to say, Lord, blessed be your name. And take away, you give and take away. My heart will choose to say, Lord, blessed be your name. Blessed be the name of the Lord, blessed be your name. Blessed be the name of the Lord. Blessed be your glorious name. Blessed be the name of the Lord. Blessed be your name. Blessed be the name of the Lord. Blessed be your glorious name. Blessed be the name of the Lord. Blessed be your name. Blessed be the name of the Lord. Blessed be your glorious name. God in my living, there in my breathing, God in my waking, God in my sleeping, God in my resting, there in my working, God in my thinking, God in my speaking. Be my everything, be my everything, be my everything, be my everything. God in my hoping, there in my dreaming, God in my walk. God in my waiting, God in my laughing, there in my weeping, God in my hurting, God in my healing. Be my everything, be my everything, be my everything. Be my everything. Christ in me, Christ in me, Christ in me, the hope of glory. Be my everything. Christ in me, Christ in me, Christ in me, the hope of glory. Be my everything. 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 Be my God in my home. God in my watching, God in my waiting, God in my laughing, there in my weeping, God in my hurting, God in my healing, be my everything, be my everything, be my everything, be my everything. Christ in me, Christ in me, Christ in me, the hope of glory. Be my everything. Christ in me, Christ in me, Christ in me, the hope of glory. Be my everything. Be my
Thank you, Jack and Alice. If you're watching through whatever form of social media, then please like, add comments so people know you're watching, and share so we can reach more people. And after the service, we'll have a 10-minute break, so do refresh your glass and join us for coffee on Zoom so we can continue in fellowship. Now, to get a flavour of what some of the church family have been up to this week, here are some of the pictures that you've sent in. As I reflected this week, listening to the news and the sense of uncertainty that seems to prevail at the moment, I was struck that many may feel powerless and at the mercy of forces completely beyond their control. Although this may not be where you are right now, many others may be worried about what the future holds. Threats to livelihood and family, feeling insecure and uncertain. And I turn to the words of Jesus in Matthew chapter 6, which I'll read from the Message. It says, if God gives such attention to the appearance of wild flowers, most of which are never even seen, don't you think he'll attend to you, take pride in you, do his best for you? What I'm trying to do here is to get you to relax, to not be so preoccupied with getting, so that you can respond to God's giving. People who don't know God and the way he works fuss over these things, but you know God and the way he works. Steep your life in God, reality, initiative, provisions. Don't worry about missing out. You'll find all your ordinary human concerns will be met. So, give your entire attention to what God is doing right now, and don't get worked up about what may or may not happen tomorrow. God will help you deal with whatever hard things come up when the time comes. This echoes the theme in Psalm 121 we read earlier. And let us now spend a moment in prayer. Center ourselves on God and breathe in his presence. Lord, I know that you care for me, have plans for me. Give me, I pray, the confidence that only can come from you, and humility as well. I trust you, Lord. My life is in your hands, and your will be done. Thank you, Lord, for being with me every step of the way, and for always providing for my every need. Amen. If you would like prayer at this time, then do send in a prayer request to the email account we've set up, prayer@twbc.org.uk, and a member of the prayer team will be available to pray for you. Or why not call a friend and share with them and pray with them? For children and young people, your activities will be starting shortly. So whether you're meeting on Zoom or using other resources, have a great time as you learn more about God and all the things he has done and will do. Now, before Bob brings us the word, a reading from 2 Corinthians chapter 9, verses 6 to 8. Remember this. Whoever sows sparingly will also reap sparingly. And whoever sows generously will also reap generously. Each man should give what he has decided in his heart to give, not reluctantly or under compulsion, for God loves a cheerful giver. And God is able to make all grace abound to you, so that in all things and at all times, having all you need, you will abound in every good work.
Well, good morning, everybody. It's indeed good to be with you. We do live in difficult times, don't we? The coronavirus seems to dominate every aspect of life. We've had severe medical issues, particularly affecting the old, and we've seen many people die as a result of that, and many others become seriously ill. We've seen many social problems as well, isolation, loneliness, mental health issues, addictions, and all these things have certainly been in the news over these last months as people have been restricted in what they can do. And thirdly, of course, there has been severe economic impact of coronavirus. Many people now are unemployed. Many of those people who are still in employment feel much less secure than they used to. The stock exchange is unstable. Government finance, for government debt rather, is escalating considerably. And indeed, economic woes are full of, well, the news is full of economic woes day after day. And that's actually the subject I want to focus on today, the economy, money. And I want to look at the sort of question is, you know, where does our money come from? Where's our security lie? And, you know, I don't tell you all this because I want to bring bad news to you. I mean, I think there's quite enough bad news on the news each day without your preachers bringing you too. But I do want to use it as a challenge, really, at these times when we're looking for security and many people are finding it increasingly difficult to find that security, particularly in their financial affairs. And so where do we look for our security? Do we look to our wealth, to our income, to our pensions, to our universal credit payment each month? Or do we actually look to Almighty God? Jehovah Jireh, God the provider. First reference to that comes in Genesis 22, in the context of Abraham. God provides, God the provider. In that passage that we heard today, it talks about having all that you need. God is in the business of providing for us. And that's what I want to look at today. I mean, you might well ask me the question, well, what's the benefit of putting my faith in God? What are you meaning? I'm looking at issues like less anxiety. I think money is something that, when we're handling it, makes us all feel a bit anxious. We're not quite sure about it and what we should do and everything else. When we put our faith in God and look to God for our security, I think our anxiety levels decline. It's wonderful to put our faith and our trust in someone who we can totally rely upon, Almighty God. The other side of that coin, of course, of anxiety and worry is assurance. And I think we can look, when we put our finances into the hands of God, we can look for more assurance. We're not reliant anymore on the whims of the world. You know, the world actually is never, the things of the world can never give total security. God can. And I think also, when we put our money into God's hands, it causes us actually for our faith in God to increase, because we're putting another area of our lives into God's hands, and we're giving God and more opportunities to show us that he's on our side, that he really is out for our good. It's another opportunity, if you like, where we can see God at work. And the fourth thing I would say there, it is right, of course, actually, and I talk to you as Christians, it's right that we honour God in all that we do. And it's right, of course, that we honour God with our money. Slight aside, but it makes the point about honouring God. Some of you remember the film Chariots of Fire, about Eric Liddell, who was a very notable Christian in the early part of the last century, and also a great runner. And he was chosen to run in the 1924 Olympics, and actually in Paris it was. And unfortunately, one of the heats for this was on a Sunday, and Eric Liddell, as a matter of conscience, felt it wasn't right to run on the Sunday. And so he refused to take part in that race. And so he couldn't compete in the end for the 100 metres. Well, fortunately, he had another opportunity, not in the 100 metres, but in the 400 metres. Someone dropped out of that, and he had an opportunity to go in that. Now, 400 metres wasn't his best race, and he wasn't really expected to win it. And as he lined up for the final of the 400 metres that day, there was an American Christian who was also competing. And he came over to Eric Liddell and he gave him a slip of paper. And on that slip of paper was a verse of scripture from 1 Samuel. And it simply said, "Those who honour me," which was God, "I will honour. Those who honour me, I will honour." And the race started. And as they say, the rest is history, because Eric Liddell won that race. And I think there is some deep truths in that. When we put our money under God's control, we are indeed honouring God. And he likes that. And indeed, we have that promise there that those who honour me, I will honour. But what do we actually mean? Let's get down to some brass tacks. What do we actually mean by honouring God with our money? I mean, we all know, don't we? The bills keep rolling in. We have to make mortgage payments if we've got one. Everything in this modern, sophisticated society requires money. We all know that. Now, what I'm not saying to you is that you go off and become a hermit and try and live without money. No, that's not what I'm saying to you. I'm talking about an attitude of the heart. See, when we become Christians, we hand over our life and our will to God. And that actually includes our money. You know, money is part of the life, part of the life that we live, and we hand that over to God. And we should look to God to provide us with our money, to guide us in our expenditure. And you know, I'm raising this subject because it's interesting. I think as Christians, we often have a tendency to think, right, now I look to God for the spiritual things in my life. You know, I look to him, I pray to him about those, but my money, well, my money, that's a practical issue. God's not really interested in my money. I'll manage my money. And indeed, it was John Wesley, the founder of the Methodist Church. He says, the last part of a person to be converted is his or her wallet. The last part of a person to be converted is his or her wallet. So what does it mean actually then to hand over our finances to God? Well, I think the key starting point there, we have to say we should be including our financial resources in our prayers, praying for what we need, asking God's guidance how we might spend it. And that's the first thing. We should be integrating our money into our spiritual lives. It's not separate. It's not detached. God, as far as God's concerned, it's part of who we are and what we do. Our money is important in God's sight. And the second thing, I think, that God requires of us is that we give generously. And that, of course, occurs in the passage that we've actually just been, that we had read to us before the beginning of this, my sermon. And I'd like to spend just a few minutes looking at that. What do we mean by give generously? And it's interesting, at the beginning of that passage, we have this trade-off. Those who sow sparingly will reap sparingly. Those who give generously will reap generously. There's this link between giving and receiving. And you must notice here, the rules of God's kingdom work rather differently to the rules of the world. In the world, if you want to get rich, you don't give your money away, you keep it tight. In God's kingdom, if you want to receive God's blessing and his provision, you're encouraged to give generously. Interesting. In the middle of that passage as well, we have these words of God, or Paul, and God through Paul is encouraging us to be a cheerful giver, that we might enjoy actually giving, enjoy parting with our money. And that's a wonderful challenge. Give cheerfully. And then we come to the end of that passage, and we have a wonderful little package, including some wonderful promises. And it starts with those words, God is able. God is able. And what's he able to do? To make all grace abound to you. Now, grace, of course, is a wonderful Christian word. And if you look at, for example, in Ephesians chapter 2, we see again Paul speaking of it. He said, it is by grace you have been saved through faith, and not by works, so that no one can boast. It is by grace that we have been saved. And that same grace that saved us is the same grace that Paul is looking here in the case of money. He, by actually, you know, actually being generous, God is able to make all grace abound to us. All our needs met. And so that we can abound in every good work. And again, I think you need to look here at the links, because they are important. You see, we're called to give generously of our goods. God then blesses us and indeed provides for us. And what does that do? That frees us up, so we can abound in every good work. That passage you see in Ephesians chapter 2, if you go on from the reference to grace, it says, but we are God's workmanship, created to do good works, which he has prepared for us in advance to do. See, God has a purpose for us in this world, and he provides for us so we can be freed up to fulfill our purposes. There we have it, you see. Generosity from us. God makes us fruitful and he provides for us. Good stuff, isn't it? Good stuff. And but there is an elephant in the room here, isn't there, which I haven't actually faced up to, and I think we're going to have to face up to now. And that elephant is quite simple. How do you define generosity? Now, if we were in a room together back in the church, which I hope we won't be too long before we are, and I were to ask you, can you please define generosity? What defines generous giving? Now, after, I don't know, maybe 80 or 100 of you, perhaps when we get back into the church and I were to go around, I wonder how many different answers I would get. I would suspect it would be 20 or 30 or maybe 40. I don't know. But my point is, there would be a lot. And we would be struggling to agree on what generosity is actually defined as. And I have to say that even if we finally got to an agreement, that in itself would not answer the point, because the point is not how we define it, it's how God defines generosity. After all, it's him we're looking to in this, not our own selves. That's what we're trying to get away from. We're looking to God. Well, so let's ask the question, how would God define generosity? I guess, where do we have to go? We have to go to the Bible. And indeed, there is pretty strong guidance, really, on what would satisfy God there. And of course, that is the tithe, 10%. It goes right through the Bible from Genesis right through into the New Testament. And indeed, it starts well before the law. It starts actually with Abraham in Genesis chapter 14. Abraham gives his tithe, his 10%, to Melchizedek. Now, Melchizedek is a rather mysterious figure and is often viewed as a sort of a Christ-like figure. He comes and he disappears again very soon. But there, the tithe is, if you like, his first reference. 400 years later, it was incorporated into the law of Moses. And indeed, the Jews took the tithe very, very seriously right through the Old Testament period. Now, when you get to the New Testament, it's often said, oh, well, you know, the law, that's history. They don't have to bother about the law anymore. But of course, it's worth pointing out that the tithe actually predates the law anyway. And Jesus actually did have something to say about the tithe, something very important about the tithe. He was if you find in Matthew 23, it's talking about the woes. He's actually condemning the Pharisees and the religious leaders, and he's condemning them for the fact that they don't take seriously justice, mercy, faithfulness, if you like, the big issues of the faith. Now, they don't take they tithe, but they don't actually take seriously that. And Jesus responds to that. He condemns the Pharisees. He says, quite simply, you should take much, much, much more seriously the issues like justice, mercy, and faithfulness. But then he adds, he said, but you should still tithe. Don't neglect the tithe. And there's a parallel passage to that actually in Luke as well. And if you think about it, it's sensible. You see, if God's people are actually going to make a difference in the big issues of justice, mercy, and faithfulness, they need money. And Jesus is saying, you know, this is God's way of raising the money so the people of God can be effective. And I think, you know, 10%, that many parts of the church have taken that 10% seriously. And I think, you know, actually, if we have to say, what would define generosity for God? Well, as the starting point, it's not necessarily the end, because the Jews used to give more than the 10% tithes, but as the foundation for generous giving, the 10% tithe, I think, is what would satisfy God. And many, many Christians have certainly gone that way. Not all, I grant you, there are people who disagree with that. But nevertheless, I think that's actually, if we had to find a figure, that 10% would be the figure that I would certainly say that is indicated by Scripture. So let's move on then. I mean, if you can take that, you can accept it or not, but let's just move on. And just try to find a little bit more. Let's flesh that out. What does that actually mean? I mean, does it mean, for example, that you give your 10%, then you just sit back and say, oh, God, fine, I've given my 10%. You provide all my needs now, please. Is it that sort of relationship we're talking about? And I think the answer has to be no. This is a long-term commitment. If we commit to tithe to God, he is committing to look after our needs. But his language is interesting. In that passage we looked at today, he sort of hedges his bets a little bit. He's put, God is able. Yes, he is. This is Almighty God. He's able to do anything. And if you, there's a passage in Malachi on the tithe. And in that, I mean, God says, test me and see. He's left himself some wriggle room here. And why has he done that? Why? I think because we have to recognize he's not a slot machine God. You know, you put your tithe in the top, you pull the handle, and your blessings pour out the bottom. You know, we can't use the tithe, if you like, to manipulate God. He's not that sort of God. He will bless in his time And in his way. And there may well be times in our lives, even if we are very committed tithers, when blessings will be withheld from us. He is, after all, Almighty God, and he sees a bigger picture than the one that we see. Another question that might well be raised is, well, I'd love to tithe. I agree. I've read the Bible. It looks good to me, but I couldn't possibly afford that. I mean, 10%? And certainly I can very much recognise that. I've been through that myself. And I'd like just to give a personal testimony now of our, that's Karen and myself, our relationship, if you like, with tithing over the years. We started to tithe in the mid-1980s or thereabouts. Why did we tithe? I guess we'd been Christians a few years, and we were feeling challenged. We'd been reading the references in the Bible about tithing. I read the book, a book by R.T. Kendall, who is very persuasive on that particular issue, and many other issues too, I might add. And we had, Karen and I, that is, we had agreed to tithe our income. Now, were we cheerful about it? Certainly not. We were certainly Karen, actually, if you want to talk to Karen, she will actually give you some interesting pictures from that period, or an interesting aspect, because we went through this together, but she's got a better memory than me, and she remembers some of the details of God's provision for us. First, from my perspective, I look back actually on what I say four areas of miracles that actually started in our lives when we began to tithe. The first one was interesting, really, because we didn't get anything spectacular happening. We didn't get any cheques dropping through the door or anything, anything of that sort. Nothing particular happened. But it was interesting that after a few months, I began to scratch my head because I was thinking, well, you know, we're giving our 10% tithe away now, but we seem to be surviving just as well now as we did when we had 100%. And I couldn't quite understand why, but, you know, there was a truth there that actually God seemed to be providing. Not quite sure how, but he seemed to be providing for us. That was the first miracle. We just didn't seem to miss the money. Now, the second, which I think is nothing to do with money, the second miracle that we saw, but I think actually is probably the most significant thing as far as I was concerned, because at that time when we began to tithe, I experienced a new assurance of faith. I had this sense of that God actually really could be relied upon, and it's something that's never left me. We've been through difficult times and everything else, but somehow I've had that assurance has stayed with me over the years, and it started at that time when we began to tithe. Now, the third issue, I have to explain, soon after that, things did begin to change, because what happened was Karen was actually already training for the ministry, but she was actually training as a non-stipendiary minister. We had three children at the time. We were fairly fully committed, and basically for the money in our lives, it relied on my job at that time. And back in the late 1980s, early 90s, I was beginning to sense a call to God myself. And as you can imagine, that raised all sorts of financial issues, you know, and well expressed by my middle son one day when he said, "Dad, how are we going to survive if you go into the ministry?" You know, that's, you know, which was a very real issue. All I can say to you is at that point in time, we began to experience miracles in our lives. And do speak to Karen. She has a better memory for all the details of these than I do. It was amazing. We actually had enough money for me to leave employment. Well, full-time. I did some part-time work when I was training, but I could leave employment, and we were funded right the way through my training period. It was a wonderful time, and we really saw God at work as he blessed us during that time. The fourth thing, which actually is probably a bit more surprising, actually, when I was preparing this, the fourth thought came into my mind, I thought, yes, that's right. Actually, you know, I became a cheerful giver. It was a big surprise to me, and it was an even bigger surprise to my wife. But actually, giving actually became a pleasurable activity. Yeah, and I smiled. I enjoyed that. That's just a personal testimony of what happened to us. Another question that could well be often sometimes is raised on this, which simply says, look, you know, it's all right for those people who've got plenty of money, but, you know, I've got such a poor, low income, whether I tithe or not wouldn't make any difference. So, you know, it's not an issue. I don't earn enough to worry. I'd like to let Jesus indeed answer that particular question. You might remember, I think it's in Luke 21, Jesus is actually in the temple and he's watching people putting their offerings into the temple plate or whatever it was at that time. And he's seeing some of the wealthy people coming and put large amounts in. And then he sees a poor widow, and she comes and she puts in two tiny coins. I think in the King James Version, they used to call them mites, but two tiny coins, and she puts them in the plate. And Jesus is watching this. And he says of her, he says, that widow gave far more than all the others who have been putting in their. She gave out of her poverty. They gave out of their wealth. And I think, again, we need to understand it's not the absolute amount of money that's important. In God's economy, it isn't the money. And in the world's economy, riches are what we want, what people go for. And it's riches that impress. In God's economy, it is the attitude of the heart that's key. And he was looking at the attitude of the heart of this poor widow who gave out of her poverty, and he affirmed her. It is the amount of money is not the significant thing in God's kingdom. It is the attitude of our hearts. And one more thing before I close, a warning, actually. Because I want to refer you to Matthew 6, verse 24 and following. In that passage, Jesus says something very interesting. He says, it's not possible to serve two masters. You'll hate the one and love the other, etc. And he goes on in that mode. And then he says, at the end of that passage, he said, it is not possible to serve God and money. Not possible to serve God and money. And it's interesting, I've got an NIV, and you might like to look in your Bible. In the NIV, money is actually the M in money is a capital M, which is rather strange. Why would they say that? And it's simply because Jesus is saying that when you look at your money in your bank account or wherever it is, you might think, oh, you know, money's a lovely servant, good to have money, and it serves our purposes. Jesus is warning us here No money is actually not very often a servant. It can become a master, and it has a desire to become a master. It wants to take control. And indeed, the more control we give money in our lives, the more control it will take. You cannot serve two masters. You cannot serve God and money. You have to make a choice. And I say this to you because, you know, at the end of this, you might decide to have a look at what you give and your finances. There probably will be two voices. There'll be the voice of God encouraging you to have a good look at it. And there'll be another voice which says, hang on a minute, don't give your money away. You might need that next month. Money has power. There is a dynamic power in money, which we need to be aware of. And that's why when we deal with our financial affairs, we need to do it in prayer to Almighty God. So we are absolutely sure that the authority over our money is God's and not any other power. So in conclusion, well, I've made my case. I think it is very important that we put our money under God's care and we follow his rules in how we should treat it. That way, I think we can rest secure, which is surely what we really want to do with our money. And I'd like to say to you, really, even if you're not convinced by my words, and you may well not be, I would just invite you, bring it, please, to the Lord in prayer. Just reflect on the whole subject and just see what God might say to you. Now, in a moment, we're going to close our service and we're going to sing a song. And it has these words in it. God, I look to you. I won't be overwhelmed. Give me the vision to see things like you do. God, I look to you. You're where my help comes from. So I pray today that God will guide you in your financial affairs, and may God bless you as you do.
God, I look to you. I won't be overwhelmed. Give me vision to see things like you do. God, I look to you. You're where my help comes from. Give me wisdom. You know just what to do.
thank you for being with us, folks, this morning. I hope you've enjoyed the service. It's been wonderful to share our time together. I'm just going to pray to close. Father, thank you for this time. Thank you we've been able to sing together, hear from your word. And I just pray your blessing on everyone nearby and further afield in their week this week. In Jesus' name, amen.